classes in your office or your home. We have lunch and learns. If you want to host a class in your office or home, please let us know. We'll be glad to do so. I'm not going to specify the next two things on the flyer. Please look at it yourself. These are the next two events that we plan to have, God willing. We would love to have all of you join us for that as well. If you, in general, want to be updated for programs and events that go on here at Chabad, most of you have either sent us your email or through Facebook, but if you want, you could send us an email, text message, whatever it is, and let us know that you'd like to be notified of future events. Again, thank you all for coming. Thank you for those who helped organize tonight's event. A special thank you to Chaya Yaris, who coordinated tonight's event. Thank you. I'm sorry, just one more quick announcement on behalf of Mrs. Cohn. We don't have enough books here tonight, thank God, because the turnout is amazing. But Mrs. Cohn has been kind enough to say that if you want to order the book online, you can get a signed book. We will give you more information on that. But again, if you want a book that's signed, you could do so via ordering online. What is the website? Okay, you'll arrange it via the office. We'll be glad to take care of it.
Good evening. Poischim b'dvar malchus. We always begin every event with a thought from Torah. State-sponsored anti-Semitism did not begin in Germany. And it did not begin with Hitler. Yamach Shemai. It actually begins in this week's biblical reading, the book of Exodus. Back in ancient Egypt, with this despot called the Pharaoh. And the first time Jews were systematically rounded up, enslaved, and crushed into pyramids takes place in this week's Torah reading. Almost 4,000 years ago, 3,500 years ago. And what's very intriguing is not merely the fact that a people persecuted for so long has survived, but that the question hasn't changed. Because today, we ask, our children ask, our parents certainly asked, how is it possible that God allowed 6 million to die? And 3,500 years ago, the question was framed by Moses slightly differently. When Moses first encounters God at the burning bush, and God says, leave the safety, the security of being a shepherd, and go back to Egypt, go back into the lion's den, save your brothers and sisters. Moses says like this, when I come back to Egypt, the very first question the Jews are going to ask me is, what is God's name? Now, what kind of question is that? What is God's name? And the rabbis explain to us that they're asking this question. What do you call a God that allows his children to be killed? What do you call a God that is deaf to the cries of his own kinderlech? What do you call a God who is indifferent to the plight of his people? Listen to God's answer. He says, my name is I will be as I will be. That's the actual verse in the Torah. And God says, my name is not God. The name God implies power. The name God implies I'm up there and you're down here. The name God implies I'm in heaven and you're suffering on earth. It's simply not true. Eye, I am with you right under the lash of the taskmaster's whip. I am there suffering. Oh, I've allowed myself to be powerless. And you know why? Because I created a world where I not only allow people the right to make a mistake, I even allowed people the right to think they are God. to play God. And that's why the Egyptians are doing what they're doing. And unfortunately, I will be who I will be. This will not be the first time I will tie my own hands and seem to be powerless. I will be with you in Egypt, and I'll be with you in World War II during the Shoah. And the reason why this conversation is so important, because I honestly, truly believe this is the secret of Jewish survival. We have this persevering notion that we will be, because as long as God is, we are too. As Rabbi Friedman said, it is really our distinct pleasure at Chabad of Coral Springs to host Marthe. I'm going to introduce you with a short story. For those of you who are not at Marthe's baby naming a couple of years ago, her name is Matl from Metz. Metz is a very well-known city in world Jewry. About 1,000 years ago, 800 years ago, 500 years ago, the greatest of our sages lived and taught in Metz, which is where Matl is from. And when Matl was a young girl, I'm not sure if this is in the book, when Matl was a young girl, 10, 12 years old, a neighbor girl, whom she was vaguely familiar with, called her a dirty Jew. She had a dozen eggs she was bringing back from the market for her mom, and she took the dozen eggs and she broke them over the head of the other girl. And Matl's mom did not invoke the 11th commandment, thou shalt not waste. She invoked the commandment before all commandments, never let an anti-Semite call you a dirty Jew.
Can you hear me at the end of the room?
Yes.
Okay. I would like first to thank Rabbi Yaras and Mrs. Yaras to have invited me tonight to meet all of you, and Rabbi Denver for a very spirited introduction. Thank you very much. And I want to thank all of you to have come so numerous to listen to my story of so long ago. And I would like particularly to thank all the very young people who are here tonight. I appreciate that very much, and I hope you will be there. Now, we will first show you a DVD. In 2004, Mr. Richard Trenck, the movie director of the Wiesenthal Center of Los Angeles, where I live, came to my home and interviewed me for 5 hours. But be reassured, the DVD will last only 10 minutes. And the DVD was made for a big bash in a hotel in Beverly Hills. It's not Mr. Richard Trenck who made that DVD, and I emphasize that. And after showing the DVD, when I will comment about it, you will understand why I told you that. Now we will show you the DVD.
Yes.
So where?
how does a young girl from a devoutly Orthodox Jewish family end up becoming a spy whose efforts helped to bring an earlier end to the war in Europe in 1945? The answer to that question was one. Marthe Cohn, born Martha Hoffnung, kept to herself for the better part of a half century. Born in 1920 in the French town of Metz in the Alsace region of France near the German border, Martha was one of seven children. She was quite religious, but at the same time mixed easily with their non-Jewish neighbors. But with war clouds on the horizon in September of 1939, the Hoffnungs and many of their Jewish neighbors decided to move to a safer part of France, away from the German border, to the town of Poitiers, southwest of Paris. However, they were not safe for long. The Nazis invaded France, and with little resistance, the French government capitulated. Immediately, life began to change.
We didn't know how bad it could be. We could not understand that, because even if we knew about Kristallnacht, it was in Germany. They did that to the Germans. They couldn't do that to the French people.
For a while, in spite of the various restrictions placed on the Jews, the Hoffnungs were able to go about their daily business. Martha started nursing school and became engaged to a young medical student. As the war progressed, resistance to the Nazis and their Vichy French collaborators became more widespread. The family began to take more chances. Martha and her sisters hid Jews who did not have the proper papers, and her fiancé became actively involved in resistance activities. One day, French police arrested her sister Stephanie, and then her father. When her father was released shortly thereafter, the family managed to escape using false papers that did not identify them as Jews. There was a plan to help Stephanie escape from the French jail she was being held at, but sadly, it failed.
She was caught in the camp, and then later she was transferred to Drancy, near Paris, and then to Pithiviers. And she wrote that they were going deported that afternoon of Yom Kippur 42.
Most of the Hoffnung family went to the mountains to join an older brother who was head of the resistance there. Martha finished her nursing studies in Marseille, occasionally getting the chance to rendezvous with Béjart. Then, in the summer of 1943, she went to Paris to work for a month in a hospital, traveling again under her false papers. She met briefly with Jacques. He was on the run for a resistance act that led of a Nazi collaborator. She begged him to stay in hiding with her.
And I told him, you cannot go back to Poitiers. You have immediately to escape and go south and go to Spain and I will join you. But he said, he has to go back to his family is in Poitiers, his brother is there. He will tell them goodbye and live with his brother and his friends as soon as he can. And he left after his examination, he left and he promised me to write me every day. And three letters arrived in the phone book.
She soon learned that Jacques had been arrested along with his brother and several friends. He was tried and then executed for his resistance activities. Broken-hearted, Martha returned to Marseille, graduated from her nursing study, and then moved back to Paris to work for a registry. She remained there until the Allies liberated France.
When we heard on the radio that the troops were entering Paris, all the church bells started ringing, and we opened the doors and we all sang the Marseillaise. The whole city was singing the Marseillaise.
Almost immediately after the liberation, Martha enlisted in the French army, where initially she worked as a social worker in the Alsace region of the country, close to her hometown. When her commanding officer learned that Martha spoke fluent German, he recruited her to join army intelligence.
I was introduced to Colonel Bouvet. He told me he needs me to interrogate people, to know what's going on, to know how the strategy of the German, if they are retreating or not retreating, and how many people are there, you know, all this military information.
After procuring information from Nazi POWs, Martha was ready for her spy mission. It involved crossing the border from Switzerland into Germany to see how entrenched the Nazis still were. She would then have to pass that intelligence on to the Allies. It took more than 13 tries to get it over the border into Germany. Her cover was that she was a German nurse trying to find out what happened to her Nazi fiancé. One day, she came upon a group of German soldiers who had retreated from the Allies.
We were walking, and among us was a non-commissioned who was an SS, and he was raving about the Jews, how much he had killed Poles and Jews and all that. And he loved, and he smelled Jews a mile away, you know, that's always what they say. He was going back to the Siegfried line. He had been wounded. He came back from the hospital. And as we walked, he fainted. So I was a good German nurse. I took care of him.
From this SS soldier, Martha was able to obtain important information about exactly what was going on at the Nazi front lines. On her way back to the Swiss border, she was able to transmit her report with the help of a Swiss farming family. Martha then crossed the border again and made her way back into Germany to see if there was anything else she could uncover.
I walked to the line to see what's going on. And when I arrived at the Siegfried line, they were all gone. The last travelers were leaving. And they told me that the Siegfried line is empty. Do you realize what an important information that was?
The information Martha uncovered helped to shorten the Allied effort to defeat the Nazis and saved untold numbers of lives. For the better part of a half century, Martha did not talk of her experiences, even with her family. But in the mid-1990s, while visiting in France, she made a request for her French army records. When officials at the French archives saw her file of commendations and achievements, the wheels were put into motion for her to be awarded the Medaille Militaire, of France's highest military honors, and the same medal awarded to Sir Winston Churchill by the French government. Why was she so quiet about her exploits over the years?
It was not modesty, but I thought that nobody would believe me. You know, usually a spy is a very tall, good-looking woman, and I didn't feel I was that type of a person at all. I was a very unlikely spy. Richard Trenck didn't make it. Somebody else at the Wiesenthal Center made that DVD. Every time I have been interviewed by the media, they very rarely repeat exactly the things like I tell them. They are always errors. And in that DVD, there are several errors. One of them, they pretend I was born in Alsace. To my knowledge, my home city of Metz, M-E-T-Z, is in Lorraine and not in Alsace. Alsace-Lorraine are two provinces which are completely different provinces. They are always cited together because their historical fate was identical. But in reality, they are two different provinces. And I was born in Lorraine and not in Alsace. So I like the Alsatians very much, and I get along with them very well, but I was not born there. Okay, the second point is much more important. My sister Stephanie was not arrested by the French police. In my book, I wrote that she was arrested by the Gestapo, because the Gestapo was the police unit, the best known police unit, which served the German government and the German army. And when they come to your home to arrest somebody, they don't tell you to what unit police units ever long. So we thought it was a Gestapo. But years later, I did some research for Yad Vashem, the museum in Jerusalem, and I discovered that she had been arrested by the Zippo, S-I-P-O, just initials of a very long German word, which means security, Sicherheit in German. And the Zippo was created by a decree signed by Hitler in March 1942. My sister was arrested June 17, 1942, to show you how efficacious the German army was. The decree signed in March 1942. The same year, in June, they are already in place in all occupied countries of Europe, arresting people. And they probably arrested people before they arrested my sister. So my sister was arrested for resistance act. She and I, we sent hundreds of people who rang our bell, and we did not know who they were, from where they came, but they needed help. And the help consisted of crossing from occupied France to non-occupied France. France was occupied by the German army 3/4 of the country, and 1/4 was governed by Marshal Pétain, who was a former Marshal of the First World War in 1914-1918. And Marshal Pétain was very loved by the French, people, because like you, liked very much Eisenhower, because he was a very successful Marshal during World War I. But Marshal Pétain collaborated 100% with the Germans. And later, after the war, he was in prison. He was a very old man, but he was in prison and he died in prison. He was never released. He was in prison because he had been a traitor to France. So just to give you a little idea of what was going on in France. But
France is divided into arts and US.
Okay, my husband is my prompter and he puts me back on track when I'm on track. So the country I told you was separated in occupied and non-occupied France. And Poitiers, where we lived, where we were refugees from Metz, was in occupied country. And very close to Poitiers, in Diennes, D-I-E-N-N-E with an accent, was a small town where a farmer, Mr. Noël Debout, that's his real name, helped thousands of people to cross from occupied to non-occupied France. A lot of Jews, of course, but also like pilots, American and English pilots, which had been shot down over France and needed to get out of occupied France as fast as they could. Most of them didn't speak a word of French, and they needed to get out of occupied France, go to non-occupied France and to Spain, and go back to England if they could. And prisoners of war who had escaped and too needed to get out of occupied France as fast as they could before they were caught by the German army. And all the people who were in danger in occupied France. And Mr. de Gaulle had done that without charging one penny. He did it by pure patriotism. And my sister and I, we sent him all these people who rang our bell. And he helped them cross from occupied to non-occupied France. But my sister was arrested because she wrote a letter to Mr. de Gaulle to send him a document, a voucher of tobacco that one young man who we had sent to Mr. de Gaulle to cross from occupied to non-occupied France, and he had forgotten that voucher in our house. If you smoke cigarettes or used any tobacco, you needed that voucher to buy. But if you didn't smoke, you bartered that voucher against food, because food in 1942 started to be scarce in all of France already, because we had vouchers to buy food, a very small quantity of food, because the Germans were stealing everything we had. France had been a very rich country before 1939, but the Germans just stole everything in our country. So, Mr. de Gaulle, my sister had written that letter to Mr. de Gaulle, and she had signed a real name, which we never did. Why she did that, we don't know, because we never asked her. It was too late. It was no use to ask her. But the Germans had a list of all the Jews since 1940, since 2 months or 3 months after they occupied France. They had a list of all the Jews. So they came to the house and arrested my sister. She was taken to the office of the SIPO and questioned. They had suspicion that Mr. de Gaulle was doing that work, but they had no proof. And they wanted my sister to give them that proof. She refused to give them any information. So they came back a little later to the house and arrested my father to put pressure on my sister so that she give that information. But she refused again, even in the presence of my father, to give any information. So she was kept. My father was released because in June 1942, the Germans had not yet started to arrest French Jews in Poitiers. I emphasize in Poitiers. At that time, luckily, we had no computers yet, so nothing was centralized. And the Germans received orders and applied them when they felt like. And that's why in Poitiers in June 42, they had not yet arrested any French Jews. So they had arrested only foreign Jews. You know that's a very important subject right now, worldwide, about foreigners. Is that better? Is that better? Can you hear me at the end? Yeah, okay. The foreigners, you know very well that it's a very important question right now, if economic or political conditions are not what they should, so foreigners are always the first target. And that's a known thing. And that was at that time too. So foreign Jews were all in a camp in the fringes of the city of Poitiers. The camp was called the Camp of the Road of Limoges. Limoges is a city south of Poitiers. And the people in that camp They were Tsigans to gypsies to in another camp adjoining. They were not together with the Jews. And the foreign Jews were there, entire families with all their children, even newborns. And they had not received any medical care until my sister arrived there. So I go back to my sister. My sister was in prison for 1 month. She celebrated her 21st birthday on July 10th, 1942 in prison. And after that month of prison, she was sent to the camp at the fringes of the city of Poitiers, where all the foreign Jews were. She was the only French Jew. And she was a medical student, and she started to give mostly to the children in the camp medical care with very poor tools, but it was better than nothing. So she, when we, the family, organized that she escaped from that camp, because we had found two French guardians in the camp who accepted to help her escape. She refused to escape because she felt that what she was doing for the children was too important. In prison, we could not visit her, but in the camp, one person of the family could go once a week. So a certain week, I decided to go to the camp, and I reminded her that her mother needed her as much as the children. And she answered me, "Don't you realize that if I escape, you're all going to be arrested?" I had never thought about it. So walking home from the camp to my home, it was a very long walk. I decided that we would all escape to non-occupied France so that she can escape too. And we escaped. We were capable to do it. We managed it, we did it. It's a beautiful story, but you have to read my book. I cannot talk to you about all the details. We would be here until tomorrow. And so I decided that, we would all escape because I knew that we could do it, because several weeks before my sister was arrested, I met in the main street of Poitiers Mr. Charpentier, with whom I had walked in the French city hall of Poitiers before being thrown out by the German military police, who came with rifles and bayonet and screamed Jews out. And in an hour, we had to leave the office. So I met Mr. Charpentier, that's his real name, too, with whom I had worked in the city hall. And Mr. Charpentier stopped me and took me to a small place, very quiet in the street, and told me, "I am sorry, but I can now provide you with identity cards without the stamp issue." I don't know if you are aware of it, but in 1942, we were already, we had identity cards without the stamp issue. When my sister was arrested, we had not yet started wearing the yellow star. That we started several weeks later. But we all had an identity card with the stamp Jew. And with the stamp Jew, You could not go to any public space, none. You could not have a telephone, imagine young girls. You could not have a young voice. You could not have a telephone. How could you live without a telephone? And you could not have a radio. You could not go to any public space, like I told you. And you could not take a bus, you could not take a train, you couldn't go to a movie, nothing, not a swimming pool, nothing. You had to sit home. And you had not the right to work. So many, many Jews who had no money starved to death because they could not work and provide for them. So, they couldn't buy food, so that's why they couldn't survive. And So my sister, no, I go back to bed. I'm sorry. So you could not take a train, like I told you, you couldn't take a bus, you couldn't go, you couldn't change residence, you had to stay where you had been registered, so they can find you later. But we hadn't understood that immediately because we were very naive. And when I asked my sister to escape, I told her she refused because she felt it was too important to help the children in the camp and give them medical care. But later she was transferred to Drancy and then to Pithiviers. Like you told, they told you in the DVD, because certain things in the DVD are right. And later, she was deported on the day of Yom Kippur, 1942, on September 21st, 1942, to an unknown destination. She could not write to us, because we were already in non-occupied France. We had already escaped. So she could not write to us. There were no postal services between the occupied and non-occupied sectors at that time. Later it was established, but not at that time. So she wrote to a friend in Poitiers, and in the postscriptum she added, "At the last rumors, we are leaving for Metz to work. So no need to dramatize." These are the last words she ever wrote, because years, years later, we found out that she had been deported to Auschwitz and she never came back. So I like to honor my sister before I tell my own story. And now I have another little subject to talk about before I go to my own story. And that subject is too very dear to my heart. 75% of Jews in France survived. That's a historical fact which is not questioned anymore. The first reference I found was at the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C., where on a huge panel it's written, 75% of Jews in France survived. You can Google it, you can find it anyway. And if they survive, it's because non-Jews in France risk their life and that of every member of the family to help us. That was punished by death. But they did it. And 75%, I told you, survived. Between 76 and 100,000 were deported from France. And about 2,500 came back. That's all. But the rest had never been arrested, and they all survived. Or if they were arrested, they survived too, in France, because we were so much help. Thousands of children were hidden in villages, and everybody in the village knew about it and helped. And nobody ever denounced them, and they all survived. And that's a fact which is very little known in the United States. And there is only one other country in Europe where more Jews survived. That was in Denmark. But in Denmark, the fishermen took the Jews to Sweden, which was a neutral country. And that's why they survived. Had they stayed in Denmark, which is a very small and very flat country, they could not have survived. But in Sweden, they all survived. So 5% who refused to be taken to Sweden were all arrested and non-survived from day one. In France, it was different. We had a lot of rural places. We had mountains, we had seaside. We had a lot of places where people could be hidden. And the non-Jews hid so many Jews. And my whole family has been constantly, during these 5 years, help. Because you didn't need just one time help. You constantly needed help. And we were helping. We all survived, but my sister was deported. So, all my brothers and sisters were extremely active in the resistance. I have no time to go in more details, so I want to go now to my own subject, what happened. As you have seen in the DVD, that I left, I joined the army, the French army, after the war, and after the liberation of Paris, in August 1944. But it was extremely difficult to join the army because thousands of people were waiting in columns to join the army. It took me several days before I reached somebody to talk to. And that person, when I reached her, was a woman. And she immediately asked me for my identity card. Oh, I forgot to go back to Mr. Charpentier. Because when Mr. Charpentier told me that he wanted to provide me identity cards for all my family, I told him that he could not do that because he risked his life and that of his wife and little boy. I had seen pictures when we walked together. And Mr. Charpentier answered me, if I couldn't help you, I could not live with myself. And I asked him how much it would cost to make all these identity cards, because we were still 7 people at home. My 2 brothers were already in non-occupied France. My oldest brother was a prisoner of war who escaped, and he managed to come to Poitiers, and he had to get out of Poitiers as soon as possible and go to non-occupied France. And he managed to do that. My second brother was in the army, the French army in Tunisia. We had colonies in North Africa. And he was sent back to France in 1940 after the Hitler and Pétain signed the armistice between France and Germany in 1940. He was sent home because the French army of Pétain did not keep any Jews anymore in the army. I told you that Pétain was 100% collaborating with the Germans. Yeah, So Mr. Charpentier, when I told him how much does it cost, he started crying. And he said to me, I do not want any money. I do that just to save you. And he provided me with his identity cards without telling you. And that's how we were able to escape, because we had cards without telling you. Okay. Now I go back to myself. When I was
in the army.
Yeah, when I went to the army. And the young woman I met, and she asked me for my identity card. So I presented the card made by Mr. Charpentier. She must have been in the underground working on forged cards, because as soon as she looked at the card, she said to me, that's a forged card. The army cannot accept it. Then she asked me for my birth certificate, and I could not provide it because Paris was liberated, like I told you, in August 1944. But Metz was only liberated in November 1944. So I couldn't get my identity, my birth certificate. And third point, I had to prove I had not collaborated with the German army. Everybody wanted to join the French army at that point needed to prove that they had not collaborated with the German army. How can you prove something you haven't done? It's impossible. So I couldn't prove it. So it took me until November 44 to join the French army. After I went to Poitiers, as soon as Poitiers was liberated, much later than Paris. And I took to Paris the mother of my fiancé that you saw in the DVD. She was all alone in Poitiers. Her two sons, her only children, had both been executed by the German on October 6, 1943 in Mont-Valérien in Paris, the worst prison in Paris. And her husband, who had been a resistant too, had been arrested for resistance act, and he was now in the camp of Buchenwald in Germany. So she was very ill. I took her to Paris and to live with my sister and my older sister and I, and we gave her the medical care she badly needed. And after she was better, she met the army, and she vowed that I was a decent person. Being the mother of two heroes who had been killed for France, and the wife of a third hero who was in a concentration camp of Buchenwald in Germany, the army accepted that she vouched for me. So I was finally accepted in the army. I was told to go to a certain place in Paris one morning where I would find a bus to take me to the front. The front in November 1944 was in Alsace, where I was not born, if you remember. I went on the bus. I was the only woman on the bus. Excuse me. And the only newcomer. All the others were officers, non-commissioned officers and soldiers who had gone on furlough to Paris and were returning to the front. So we had a lot of trouble because the engine of the bus needed repair constantly. And we had another problem. We had not enough gasoline. The government, the French government, had nothing anymore. I told you before, the German had stolen everything we had. But the only ones who had gasoline was the American army. And the French First Army, to which I was assigned, was quasi independent strategically, but it depended completely on its resources on the American army. And we were in the same sector in Alsace as the 6th Army of Platten and the 3rd American Army. And we went, two officers on the bus, and they always took me along because they thought that would help, but it didn't help at all. They took me to the officers of the Americans and asked for gasoline. And the officers there looked at our officers and said, French army, no way. We are not going to give you any gasoline. So we had only one option. We stole the gasoline from unattended jeeps on the roads. And that's how we managed to get to the front. And we arrived very, very late at night. And I was the only newcomer, so I was immediately debriefed, that means interviewed by an officer of intelligence. In every regiment of every army of the world, there is at least one officer of intelligence. So that officer debriefed me and asked me immediately what I had done during the resistance. I told him that my sister, who had been deported, and we had sent hundreds of people to Mr. De Coup, and I explained to him people who wanted to leave the occupied France and go to non-occupied France. And we saved a lot of people. And after that, I did things on my own, but I was never able to join a group of resistance. Several times I had been interviewed by chiefs of the resistance in the attics of big buildings in Marseille and Paris, because it was highly secret. And every time they looked at me. As you have seen, I am not very tall. But I was taller than I am now. I was 4'11". I was very thin, very blonde, with blue eyes and very light skin. And they felt, without even questioning me, they felt that I had no substance, that I was a bimbo. And they never accepted. And I told that to the captain. And he said to me, that's a lot of baloney, and he used a much more vulgar term. You should have gone in the streets and killed a German. And I answered him, I am a nurse, I take care of people, I don't kill anybody, even Germans who I hate. And he said, you see, you are not fit to be in the army. And he too wanted to send me back to my mother. And I told him, no, I had enough trouble coming here. So headquarters in Paris sent me, I am going to stay. So furious, he told me, as a registered nurse, you should be an officer. But because you were such a coward during the resistance, I make you sergeant. And I just shrugged my shoulders because I couldn't care less what grade he was giving me. So more furious, he told me, I do not need any nurses. I have enough nurses. You are going to be a social worker. I was trained as a nurse. I had not the slightest idea what it entailed to be a social worker. But in the army, and that counts for every army of the world, if they tell you that you are a social worker, that's what you are. So I left his office and went to the village where all the people who were not on the front were lodged in homes in the village. I got a room and I slept all night, and the next morning I got up and put on the American uniform I had been given. I told you all our resources came from the American army. But that American uniform was much too big for me, because the American army had no uniform my size. But it was warm, which was very important, because the winter of 1944-1945 was unusually cold. So I put on that uniform and I wondered what I should do, because nobody gave me any indication of what I was supposed to do as a social worker. So I decided I'm going to visit our troop at the front. I inquired, I crossed a small forest, and I arrived at the canal. There are lots of canals in Germany, in Alsace. And our troops were on the western side of the canal. The German had retreated several days earlier on the eastern side of the canal, which was quite narrow, like most man-made canals. And I entered the foxholes of our troop, and they were very surprised, because they had never seen a social worker in their foxholes. And I asked them what they needed, and they requested mostly underwear, socks, hats, scarves, blankets, food, reading and writing material. And I went back to the village, and the villagers gave me a lot of things. They were extremely generous for our troops. And that's what I did for several weeks. And one day, crossing the square of the village at lunchtime, I met the colonel of the regiment to which I was assigned, the 151 Regiment of Infantry, who had been a regiment in my hometown of Metz before 1939. And I met Colonel Pierre Fabien, that was his name that he used during the resistance that he kept in the army. And he had been the one in 1943 who killed the first German in France in the metro station Barbès-Rochechouart in Paris. And Pierre Fabien has now another metro station which bears his name. You can all Google that and you find it. And Pierre Fabien stopped me and asked me to come to his office and answer his phone during his lunch break. So I went with him in his office and he showed me around and leaving. He was very good looking, which doesn't hurt anything. And he was also extremely courteous. And he said to me, "I am sorry, I have nothing to read for you. There are only German books here." And I answered, "But that's quite all right. I read German fluently." So extremely interested, he walked back towards me and asked me if I spoke German. And I told him yes, as well as French. Then he explained to me that in the German army, all males from the age of 12 to old age are in uniform in the army. So any man in civilian clothes which would walk in the streets of Germany would be immediately noticed and arrested. That's why they needed women to do that type of work. So he asked me if I accepted to be transferred to the intelligence service of the First French Army, the army to which we belong. And I accept. He left. I sat on a chair and wondered in what predicament I had put myself, but it was too late. 2-3 days later, two officers came from Mulhouse and took me to Mulhouse, where I underwent an extensive training for what I was going to do. And once that training was finished, they asked me to devise my own alibi, so it sticks better than an alibi given to me. So I devised my alibi, presented it, defended it, it was accepted. And after that, I was assigned to the Commandos of Africa. You heard on the DVD that I met Colonel Bouvet. He commanded the Commandos of Africa, which came with the First French Army from North Africa. And they had fought in North Africa, they had fought in Italy, in Corsica, and now they were fighting in France. I was very flattered to be assigned to such a regiment. And Colonel Bouvet asked me first two questions: German prisoners of war, to find out what is the plan of retreat of the German from Alsace to Germany. We are now in January, February 1945. The Germans are desperately fighting to prevent the Allied armies to enter Germany in Alsace. They had counterattacked in Belgium just a few weeks earlier and had lost that battle, and now they were counterattacking in Alsace. To give you the proof how terrifically they were fighting, the day I met the Commandos of Africa, I met them very late at night because I always met everybody late at night. But that morning, they had been fighting in the forest of the city of Cernay, Cernay, in Alsace. And they had lost that morning 192 dead and over 200 wounded. The Commandos lost all that morning, to show you how desperately the Germans were fighting to prevent us to cross from Alsace into Germany. So I interrogated prisoners of war. They were colonels and generals, because the subaltern officers wouldn't have known anything about the plan of retreat. And I obtained important information. I can boast about it because it's written in a citation of one of my medals on the table, that I provided Colonel Bouvet with very important information on the plan of retreat of the Germans from Alsace to Germany. Now, every army in the world has as well a plan of retreat as a plan of attack, because you never know how things will turn out. So after that, Colonel Bouvet asked me to cross the front in Alsace. And in the DVD, they told you that I tried to cross 13 times. I made 13 attempts to cross the border between Switzerland and Germany, which is absolutely not true. I tried once and I made it. But when I tried to cross the front in Alsace 13 times, I could not do it. There were many reasons. I will give you two. One of them, during the war, since a very fluid, things move very fast. So I was told what I would find at a certain point and how to proceed from that point. But I couldn't find that. So I couldn't proceed because things had changed. So since I had given the order the night before. And another example, we had military guides who knew extremely well the region and would explain to me exactly what I will find on the ground from A to B and how to proceed from A to B on that ground. But they are humans, they make mistakes. And I give you an example. One night, I was taken always very late, around 12 o'clock, I was taken to a road by two officers of the intelligence department of the First French Army. And they explained to me that I would cross a huge field in front of us, covered with snow. And I would go to a little town northwest of that field and find a German, a small German unit, which was going to retreat, but still in Alsace, not yet in Germany. And mix with them, go with them, and send back as much information I can. So I left. It was a very dark and very cold night on in February 1945. And I had a little suitcase with a change of clothes, of which I had taken all the labels off to make sure nobody could tell they come from France. But I had no radio, I had no arm, I had no maps, I had nothing written. Everything I needed to know was in my memory. So I had probably more things, but I don't remember. Anyway,
no flash.
Yeah, I had not even a flashlight. My husband reminds me. So I left by the dark and very cold night and started crossing that huge field covered with snow. And suddenly, I heard a huge crack, and I felt myself submerged in the ice-cold water of a canal. The guide had only forgotten to tell me that there was a canal in that field. So I popped up and tried to get out of the canal, which was narrow, like most man-made canals. And I tried to grasp the side of the canal, which was cement, and in summertime it's grass, but in wintertime it was nothing. So I tried to grasp, and I couldn't grasp sufficiently to get out of the canal. I was now much heavier because I was drenched in that ice-cold water from head to toe. And it took me a long time to get out of the canal. You understand that I was in civilian clothes. When you go on mission, you are not in uniform. And you cannot call for help. You have to do it on your own. So I finally found a place where I was able to manage to grasp sufficiently to get out. And I walked all night, drenched in that ice-cold water, and I never found the town that I was looking for. And at daybreak, I saw the prints of my shoes show that I had walked in circles all night. And years later, I read in a magazine that if you have no compass and no other marks to direct you, and you in a dark night, you are going to walk in circles. And that explained to me why I had done that very weird thing that I had never understood. But after that, the captain of our intelligence service decided that I was going to go into Germany through Switzerland. So I was taken down Swiss. Switzerland was neutral. But they had helped the Germans as long as the Germans were successful. Now we started to be successful, they were helping us. That's neutrality. So I was taken by an officer of our intelligence service to Basel, a city in Switzerland, where I met again Colonel Reinhardt, I had met before, which is a fictional name. Colonel Reinhardt, who commanded the intelligence service of the Swiss custom in Basel. And Colonel Reinhardt accepted that I crossed from Switzerland into Germany. And he called an agent, Mr. Le Maire, another fictional name, to take me to the border. So Mr. Le Maire took me by car to Schaffhausen, another city in Switzerland, which is very, very close to the city of Singen, S-I-N-G-E-N, the first city in Germany where I was supposed to go. And Mr. Le Maire stopped the car near a small forest. We got out of the car and we crossed the forest by foot, and on the other side of the forest, he showed me again a huge field. There are a lot of fields in my store. And that field was bordered on the northern edge by a small country road. Now, the forest and the field were Switzerland, but the road was Germany. And the road had no barrier whatsoever in that field. You could walk from the field onto the road without any trouble. But the road was protected by two heavily armed German military sentinels, who came from one, from the eastern edge of the width of the field, walked toward about the center of the width of the field. The other sentinel came from the west, met him. They talked 2-3 seconds, turned their back, and walked to the edge of the field. And they were doing that constantly, without stopping. And Mr. Le Maire told me, towards evening, you are going to crawl. When both sentinels separate and turn their backs to you, walking towards the edges of the field, you are going to crawl along the field and hide behind the bushes near the road. And when the 2 sentinels come back and meet again, they met just in front of the bushes. They didn't know what they were doing. So when they come back and meet again and separate, it turns them back to you. You walk on the road, you walk towards the east, towards the right, towards Singen. Very well. We stayed all afternoon in the forest. Mr. Le Maire was a middle-aged man. I was 24 years old. And he talked to me about his wife and children and a lot of other things. But suddenly in the afternoon, with a very strange smile, he said to me, "You may be killed tonight, so why don't we have a good time now?" But that was not on my agenda. So after that, we talked about other things. And towards evening, he told me, "Now is the moment." So I took my little suitcase and I started crawling and hid behind the bushes. Until then, everything was perfect. But once behind the suitcase again, my husband reminds me, had no compass, no arm, no radio, a nothing written, but I had something new. I had vouchers for Germany to go to take buses, to take trains, to go to restaurants and go to hotels. And I had money, German money, all that hidden in my suitcase, with my clothes without labels. But I had no radio, I had no arms, I had no maps and nothing else written with me. Everything I need to know was again in my memory. So I once behind these bushes, I suddenly realized the immensity of what I was going to undertake. Until that moment, I had never a minute time to think what I will do in Germany. But at that time, I had to wait until the German sentinels come and leave again. I first suddenly realized how terrible that the whole thing was. And I realized holes in my story. I had been given these vouchers just the day before. And I was told there for, like I told you, there for restaurants, for hotels, for buses and for trains. But nobody in my service could tell me how to use these vouchers because nobody knew. I was sent to Germany for two purposes. I was sent for one reason, for military information, of course, but also for information of how the civilians were reacting to the war and behaving, which was extremely important to know for our Allied armies, which were going to invade Germany. So I suddenly realized the holes in my story. I realized too that I had forgotten, and they had forgotten to tell me, the name of the clinic I was supposed to work in Konstanz in Germany. I didn't know the name. And I realized that we had completely forgotten to talk about it. So I became so terrified that I was completely paralyzed by fear. And I was too, I became irrational to a terrible point. To give you an example, when Mr. Lebert told me that I was going to crawl along the field, I was wearing silk stocks, because at the time we had no nylon, we were wearing silk stocks. And they were very expensive. So I put on knee-high white socks to protect my silk stocks. But once behind the bushes, I was so irrational that I thought the whole German army could see my socks, my white socks. And I became absolutely paralyzed by fear. And it took me a very, very long time to overcome that fear. But something suddenly clicked in my brain, and I remembered something, and I got up when both sentinels separated and turned their backs to me, walking to the edges of the field. I went up, got up, took my little suitcase, walked on the road, and walked towards the sentinel who was coming back from the eastern edge. I raised my right arm, I cannot do that, I have a very bad right shoulder, and I said, "Hi, little." And he asked me for my identity papers. I was now called Martha Ulrich. And I told you I had a whole alibi. And when he took my card and checked it, I wondered if he was going to discover that it was a forged card by my intelligence service. But lucky as I am, he didn't ask any question, and he gave me back my card, and I left. and I walked into Germany. Now I was in Germany. It will take me 15 more minutes to finish my story. Are you willing to listen? So, thank you. So, you have seen in the DVD that I was as far as Freiburg, and my sector was from the Swiss border to Freiburg, which was a huge sector. And in Freiburg, I had met that SS that was talked about in the DVD, because I told you that I was sent to Germany to discover how the civilian Germans were reacting to the war and behaving. So I was watching, because I didn't know anything about how they behaved. And I noticed that in daytime, if they wanted to go somewhere, they had to walk because of the bombardments of the Allies. No transportation was working, functioning in daytime. No train, no military cars, no buses, nothing was functioning in daytime, only at night. So in daytime, when the Germans wanted to go somewhere, they had to walk. And they usually walked in groups, because Germans don't like to do things individually. They are not individualists at all like the French. So I noticed that. So I went with that group which was going in the direction I wanted to go, northwest of Freiburg. And in that group was a non-commissioned officer, that SS. And as he immediately told us, he immediately told us that he had been on the Russian front where he had been wounded, and he's coming back from the hospital after being better, and he's now assigned to the Siegfried Line. And as we walked, he was telling us all the atrocities that the SS were committing on the Russian front. I was a Western person. We did not know anything of what was going on the Eastern Front. The American and English government kept us completely in the dark. We knew only where the front was, but nothing of what was going on. So that was the first time I heard the atrocities committed on the Eastern Front. There were atrocities committed on the Western Front, but there was nothing compared to what was going on the Eastern Front. And that's the first time I heard that. And the Germans around us were pushing him, provoking him to give more details. They loved it, to hear all these atrocities they were committing. And they were slapping, they do that, the Germans. They were slapping their thighs and saying, "Ach Mensch," which is like "oh boy" in English. So as we walked, he was constantly talking. We were walking at a good pace. It was quite warm. He suddenly fainted. I was a German nurse. I took care of him. And when he regained consciousness, he was so grateful that I had taken care of him, that he invited me to visit him at the Siegfried Line, and he gave me his phone number. But for 3 weeks, I did not go back to the Siegfried Line. I had other things to do. But 3 weeks later, I came back to Freiburg, and I heard on the German radio that the Allied armies were very close and were going to invade Freiburg. I decided to walk back to the Siegfried Line to see what was going on there, because that was extremely important. So I walked back to the Siegfriedland. It was 10 kilometers. I walked enormous amount in Germany. And when I arrived at the Siegfriedland, I discovered that the Siegfriedland had been completely evacuated. They were the last travelers were leaving, and they told me they're all gone. Your boyfriend is gone. They thought he was my boyfriend. They're all gone. And we are the last one to leave. So I asked several stragglers to make sure I had the right information. And when I was absolutely sure of that information, I walked back as fast as I could to Freiburg, another 10 kilometers, because I understood immediately how important that information was. If our troops had not to fight against the Siegfriedland, which was an atrocious project, then they could much faster occupy the rest of the south of Germany, which was not yet occupied. And I walked back to Freiburg, and Freiburg was completely deserted. All the Germans had heard on the radio that the Allied armies were very close and were going to invade. And it's very frightening. I was in Poitiers when the Germans invaded Poitiers. I can tell you it's awfully frightening to have a foreign army invade your country. And I was all alone in the center of Freiburg. I went to the main artery and I waited. And suddenly a tank arrived and rode towards me. I had no papers, absolutely nothing to prove who I was. I had to prove to them that I was a friend and not an enemy. So I went in the middle of the street and I raised my right arm as high as I could. And I made the V sign of Winston Churchill, the victory sign, because everybody in Europe knew that sign. And that was the proof that I was a friend and not an enemy. But I did not know how they would react. And the tank, because I'm extremely, extremely lucky in life, the tank did not kill me but stop. And I asked for the officer in charge to come down and talk to me. And he came. I was quite assertive, I must say. And he came down and I told him that I had extremely important information and take me immediately to headquarters in Freiburg. And there again, I was extremely lucky because it was the French army which invaded Freiburg. You can all Google it and see, I tell you the truth. Because if it had been an English-speaking army, I would have trouble communicating with them because I did not speak English yet. So, but with the French, there was no problem. So he took me by tank to the headquarters, and when I arrived at the headquarters, I met Commander Petit of the 2nd Zouave, another regiment from North Africa. And Commander Petit immediately told me, who tells me the truth? It may be a trap. So I wrote to him a phone number on a piece of paper, because we had the same technology as the American army. We could call anybody in the field. And Commander Petit called my service, who reassured him that he could trust me, and they were happy to know that I was still alive, because remember, I had no radio, so I couldn't communicate very often with them. And Commander Petit sent a patrol to the secret line to verify my information. They came back later and said, that's true, the Siegfried Line is completely evacuated. So I was that evening a very important VIP in the French headquarters of Freiburg. And I was invited for dinner. I was given a room, and the next morning at breakfast, Commander Petit asked me if I wanted to go back to my intelligence service. I told him, no, my mission doesn't terminate until the armistice. I have to cross the front this morning again. But I asked him for a huge, huge service. I asked him for a bicycle because I was tired of walking. And he gave me a bicycle. And then I left and I rode him down from a big summit because there are big mountains in the south of Germany. I saw stopped along the road a group of German military ambulances. And the colonel, who was a doctor, I recognized his senior immediately, and his entourage were all standing there. So I stopped to see what they were doing there. When you're in the intelligence and you see something unusual, you stop to inquire. And I talked to them, and they told me that that night they were going to cross into Switzerland and from there to Austria because they did not want to be prisoners of war of the French army which invaded Freiburg. And I even
told them.
Yeah. They asked me from where I come, and I told them that the same morning I had escaped from Freiburg because I was terrorized and terribly afraid of the French army, which had Moroccan, Algerian, Tunisian, and black soldiers, which was the truth. That's exactly what our army had. But if you remember how racist the Germans were, you can realize what effect it had on them when I told them that. So, yeah, and I told them too that I was very disappointed and very afraid because our German army was not defending us anymore as much as they should. And after a little time, the colonel told me, don't be so afraid. The war is not ended. And he told me exactly where the remnant of the German army was hidden in ambush in the Black Forest. And that information, I was able to get to my service. I had no radio, so I had to walk into Switzerland and give my letter, which I did not take the time to code because that is a very long process and I did not want to waste time. Give my letter written in French that I had hidden in my left pocket with my hand on top of it to protect it, big protection. I gave that letter to the Swiss customman I met in Switzerland after many other adventures, but you have to read my book for the book. But very bad adventures, but I made it finally. Because Colonel Reinhardt had told me that if ever I have trouble in Germany, to go into Switzerland and talk to the Swiss customer, but tell him that I'm a Swiss agent, not French. That's what I did. So that Swiss agent, that Swiss customer, sent my letter to Colonel Reinhardt, who later I heard got it that morning like I had asked him. And Colonel Reinhardt read it and then transferred it to my service, and that's why I got all these medals.
We're going to continue with some questions, but since I see some are leaving, I do want to recognize the honorable former mayor of Parkland and current commissioner of Broward County, Michael Udine. Thank you very much. As well as, again, a reminder, on your way out, please do the mitzvah and see if you could be swabbed, if we could help this young child. A big thank you also to Chosen Bean, who is sponsoring tonight's coffee. You're welcome to help yourself with coffee. I'm sorry. The parking outside, there's a lot of cars. Be careful how you pull out so you don't scratch or crash into another car.
Yeah, but somebody must have come. The French army had to come. If it was not a tank, it would have been soldiers walking. So whoever came, I would have asked the same thing. Okay? I was trained to do it. It was a job. You don't even need courage. You just do your job. That's all. Any other question?
There's a question in the back.
Did you stay in France after the war, or where did you go after?
No, not much. Not much. I was in Vietnam for 3 years after I left Germany. And then I went back to France for 3 years, and then I went to Switzerland to get my degree of nursing in Switzerland. And that's where I met my husband, who imported me to the United States in 1956. But I go back to France at least once a year now. Okay. Do you have any other questions? Any other questions? Go ahead.
How many years are you married?
Oh, over 58 years. Okay. In February, next month, it will be 59. No, Mr. Chevalier was never arrested. And Mr. De Gou, Iso, was never arrested. And Mr. De Gou got in 2011 the title of Just Among the Nation from Yad Vashem. And Mr. Charpentier got a salon of the city hall named for him. Yes, after I came back to France after the armistice, I met him and I told him that we all survived due to his papers. I told him. I became an officer when I went to Vietnam as a nurse, because as a nurse you are an officer. But before that, I was never offered the title of officer. They promised me they would give it to me, but they never did. And I never asked for it, because I feel, or you get it, or you don't. But I never asked for it.
One more question. Two more questions.
After the war, did you ever get to meet any of the people that you helped escape or smuggle out?
Look at the war. No. Do you know, I was very little in France during after the war. I never really lived very long in France after the war. Immediately after the war, I went to Vietnam for 3 years as a nurse. Not no intelligence anymore. That was finished forever.
First of all, it's an honor to hear you speak. My parents were survivors, so I really appreciate the fact that you're speaking and telling your story. I'm wondering what are your thoughts about all the anti-Semitic events that are happening in Europe today?
Oh, I don't want to go into that. Sorry. I am not an expert, and I don't want to go into that. Thank you.
She's afraid they might recruit her as a spy again. Well, there's no doubt, I think, in anybody's mind over here that it's due to her total selfless sacrifice on behalf of many of us are here today that God has blessed her with the longevity. May Hashem continue to bless you until 120 with good health to be able to inspire the next generation. Thank you very much.